Hello and welcome to Newsclcik. Today we're going to discuss the Surgical Strike 2, as it has been called by some, and the airstrike really on the Jaish-e-Mohammed camp claimed by the government of India. Raghu, what is this airstrike that has been being talked about, and what is the impact that it has had on the ground from the reports that we have?
Well, firstly, the airstrike as a strike by a fairly large set of Mirage aircraft and quite deep into Pakistani territory beyond the Jammu and Kashmir, and not within the restricted area of the LOC region per se.
What you're saying is it's beyond the what we India calls the Pakistan.
The Pakistan administered Kashmir.
Administered Kashmir.
And from that point of view, it is the first air incursion by India into Pakistan since the 1971 war. So it has significance in that. Secondly, of course, if the strike has been as successful as is claimed, and I think we will come to know in subsequent days how successful or not it has been, then if it has been a strike against established Jaish training camps at such a location, Balakot, which is, as I said, fairly deep inside the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa area of Pakistan, it's a significant development. Implications of this, I think, remain to be seen, depending on how geopolitics unfolds.
Narrowly, if we look at the strike itself,
yes,
the Pakistan representative, the military spokesperson, has claimed it was really not a deep strike.
Right.
The Indian Air Force was turned back,
right,
and it dropped its bombs in an uninhabited area. On the other hand, we have at least the reports which indicate that it is relatively deeper.
That's right.
But we do not know the extent of the damage.
That's right.
How many aircraft participated, and what is the kind of bombs used?
It is said that there were 12 aircraft. How many of them actually went deep inside, we don't yet know.
This is Mirage.
These are Mirage Dash 2000, and these are the upgraded Dash 5 IN variants. And as you may recall, India has undertaken a fairly serious upgrade of the Mirages, and these were done by Hindustan Aeronautics in order to bring them up to date with more contemporary avionics and better weapons systems. It seems as if in this particular strike, 1,000 kilo laser-guided bombs, which are Israeli manufactured and using Israeli laser guidance pods, have been used. These pods are on the underside of the Mirages.
So, we have now reports of the Pakistani deliberations. The security committee met, and the Prime Minister Imran Khan has given a statement. And he has said that they're going to take the media, international media also, right, to the spot to show nothing has really happened.
Right.
Yes, bombs have been used, but they have fallen into essentially empty areas and with causing minor damage.
Right.
And I think some reports indicate one person has been injured.
Right.
Assuming that no significant damage has happened, which it seems if the Prime Minister of Pakistan is saying this is a possibility, of course there is other possibility. Before they take the people, they will remove all
sanitize the
area. All these are possibilities. So we can't really comment on the extent of what has happened right now. Maybe in a few days, things will become clearer. Gautam, how do you see this play out between India and Pakistan? Do you see that this standoff likely to continue in the Kargil model? Or do you think that having done this, therefore, India can claim, well, we have retaliated against the Pulwama suicide bombing, and therefore our honor is satisfied, and therefore it will really be something that both countries can, for the time being, forget except the saber rattling and move on to in India elections And in Pakistan, what Imran Khan has promised to do, put the country back on the development path again.
Looks quite likely to play out along the lines that you've suggested. The reason for thinking like that is because if you see the 2016 so-called surgical strike, which was actually a border raid, which went 500 meters to 2 kilometers inside, where they actually attacked the launch pads and some people did die, 39 odd trainers, guides, as well as supposed to be militants who were killed in that. But even then, the DGMO of Indian Army contacted his counterpart and informed him promptly that this was aimed against the militants and it was not against the Pakistan Army. If you look at the statement issued by the Indian Foreign Secretary, he makes it very clear that the target was Jaish-e-Mohammed camp, which he described as the biggest camp. Therefore, it was also sending a message to Pakistan that, well, we were directing our attack to a militant camp and not to any Pakistan military asset or anything. Which means seems to suggest to me that exactly like it happened in 2016, I don't expect anything more to happen. There'll be noises made.
It's an interesting point that you're raising, because the statement of the Foreign Secretary goes even further. It says a non-military attack on essentially, what is the words actually used? Non-military attack is a preemptive attack.
That's right. Preemptive.
So he calls it a preemptive, non-military preemptive attack. Of course, if we use Air Force, it's not non-military. But what he probably means is not against your military.
Yeah,
that's what seems to be the intention. And he doesn't call it a retaliation against the Pulwama.
No.
He calls it a preemptive attack because of another attack was forthcoming from Jaish. So we took preventive action.
Can I add something here? It's also very interesting if you read the statement of the Pakistan's foreign minister, Qureshi. He says that now that this attack has taken place, he hopes that sense would dawn in India. Now, why would they make a suggestion like that? Unless it seems to me as if it was something which was, so to say, state managed. I'm not saying that the both sides came to an agreement that they would do it. But it looks like something where each side is very careful that they do not allow it to escalate beyond their control and result in a bigger combat or confrontation, which they would like to avoid.
You know, but I have two reservations on this. One is that even the First World War did not start with an intent to start the war. So you have unintended consequences. And second is both sides, how much control they have over each other and themselves, given the fact India is now in an electioneering mode already, and the Prime Minister has already started his campaign. So how much of this saber rattling is controllable, and is there a chance of it spinning out of control?
As you suggest, these things are always, however hard you try to calibrate measures, there's always a chance of things spiraling out of control, some trigger-happy divisional commander going off on a tangent. They are likely. In this case, my sense also is India seems to have taken the United States to some extent into confidence that such a strike was going to happen. And as you know, President Trump, who can't, I think, keep quiet for very long, promptly announced virtually 2 or 3 days ago that India is going to take some strong action. So it was clear that something was forthcoming and India had informed the US. And I think India would also have taken the step and the US would have correspondingly discussed this with Pakistan, saying, look, this is going to happen. It's not going to be aimed against your military. So you also cool it down and just let it pass. But as you say, things don't always follow intentions. If there is no other response coming from Pakistan, if there are no follow-up further actions by India, then I think things should tamp down from this. But time will tell.
Yeah, Gautam, I would like to ask you, you're also an observer of what's happening in Pakistan. Doesn't this also challenge Imran Khan's prime ministership? Because after all, he's taken charge very recently, that if there's no response that is seen at all, and let's not forget, you know, this is how it can always escalate.
That's right.
What is the calibration of a response beyond which the other person will not retaliate further? And is that a possibility? Can Imran Khan really not respond at all, or can he just respond diplomatically?
Well, I believe that the chances that Imran Khan's regime today would retaliate, I rule it out for two reasons. You're absolutely right that things can go out of control even at the, you know, the no matter how well you control all the actors and activities that are going around, things can go out of control. One of the most strongest arguments in favor of saying that there may not be an escalation is precisely because of Indian elections around the corner. This matters as much for Indians as much for Pakistan too. I'll come to explain why I believe so. The second is, I think while Pakistan would be tempted and would be under pressure, definitely, to retaliate, going by what happened in 2016, where actually the body count was available to us and there was some, at least some credible evidence to suggest that some number of people did die. This time around, we don't have any such luck. Since it was an aerial strike, we have to rely now on international media to provide the evidence of body count. And it's the body count that will count. If there is very little, if Pakistan has suffered very little casualties, I don't see them coming under pressure. But if it is true that they've suffered as much as what the Indian claim, that they have killed 300 militants, then of course they'll be under pressure. So a lot depends on that evidence.
There's also an interesting issue. The Iran has also threatened Pakistan for a Fedayeen strike inside Iran. Of course, at that time, it was not the local Iranian blowing himself up. It really seemed to have come across the border. So we have had two similar actions. Sure. One, of course, in this case, supported by Jaish, claimed by Jaish, but really, as we now know.
And it's the same Jaish, actually, which are actually umbilically linked.
Yeah, and in fact, more or less at the same time.
Within 24 hours.
Within 24 hours.
So 24 this, hours, yeah. This is also, there is this other part that sees a connection between the Saudi, the Pakistanis, the Jaish, who are all, in some sense, Iran being clearly a Saudi target, and India being clearly a Pakistan target. So this, and given the fact that Pakistan, Taliban, and American triangle is also now playing out differently, Pakistan is on an internationally a stronger wicket than it was earlier.
Also because they matter so much for the Americans if they have to pull back their troops by keeping their prestige intact. Otherwise, they'll face a Saigon-like situation, I'm sure, in Afghanistan.
So Afghanistan, Pakistan extremely critical for Afghanistan if they want to de-escalate or draw down their forces. Yes. Thank you very much, Raghu and Gautam, to be with us for this discussion. Do keep watching NewsClcik and our other discussions.